And we're here. Welcome, everyone. This is Carlos Phoenix. I am here to introduce our first episode of Garage. And the reason it's called Garage is because, well, if you look at a lot of our big companies out there, a lot of them started in a garage. And for now, we look at them and they're multi-billion dollar companies. And so the idea of the show was to bring super talents that started, you know, as basic as they come and then are now successful. And so I have a special guest today. He's an old friend of mine from high school. His name is Steve Loader. And now Steve Loader is going to be my first guest in this show. And it means a lot to me because, one, it makes me a little bit more comfortable instead of me interviewing someone I don't know anything about and have to research him and stuff like that. But my first guest is known for directing and producing projects such as Kim Possible, Brandy and Mr. Whiskers, American Dragon, Jake Long. He's also directed Happy Monster Band, Buzz Lightyear and Star Command, and Disney's Legend of Tarzan series, as well as episodes of The Ren and Stimpy Show, Duckmen, Stressed Eric, and Kevin Smith's Clerks, the animated series. He's won a Primetime Emmy for The Penguins of Madagascar as a 2012 for Outstanding Animated Program. He's currently an executive producer for two projects. One is Marvel's Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur, which we'll be talking about today, and The Ghost of Molly McGee, which, from my understanding, there was some recognition for that show as well today. Hello, welcome, Steve.
Hi. Well, first, I got to say it is an honor to be the inaugural guest of Garage. This is very cool. I did not know that. That's awesome.
Well, you know, I had to throw in some surprises. You're the one that's going to be talking about all this stuff. So I had to throw in a special surprise. It's great to see you. It's been a long time, and it's always amazing to see you. And you look sharp as before. The last interview we did was for another show, and you know, internet was different back then, and now we're like super sharp and super clean, and I love it. So I hope I'll be able to watch you grow even more, because it's just been since high school. I mean, well, let's start the conversation. So we grew up together, went to High School of Art and Design in Manhattan, and I was working in advertising and you were working already professionally. So let's start from there. How did you, I think we semi-talked about it, but we never really got into the step-by-step. And I like to kind of introduce to people, you know, here we were, we're kids. We're like 15, 16 years old. And well, I know how I got into advertising, but how did you get entangled into this world?
Well, I mean, New York in the 90s was a really interesting and creative place. And though we didn't have the internet and we didn't have the same level of social interaction as we have now, you know, we kind of hustled to kind of be seen as artists. And so my brother and I saw that there was a Disney artist drawing characters at a mall in New Jersey. So we collected some of our drawings. We went down to the mall, I think it was Woodbridge, New Jersey, possibly. And we showed it to this Disney artist and he really liked the art. He says, this is great. He said, so, you know, as soon as you guys are, you know, as soon as you're done in high school, give me a call. And we did. My brother got hired immediately because he was in college, but it took me about a year or two. And then the second I graduated from high school, I went to start working for Disney Consumer Products in New York City, which is, so I was drawing Mickey for t-shirts, bed sheets, merchandise, basically. So that's kind of, so I kind of bypassed college and got to work immediately in a bullpen with a bunch of other well-known professionals. I mean, there was some heavy hitters in there, some major underground comic artists and other talents that I had known about, that I was a fan of, and now I'm in a bullpen drawing with them. So I think that was kind of my schooling was actually at that time.
Now, so you're saying that you did not go to college. Is that?
I did not.
So one thing I find amazing, and other guests that I'll have will probably have a similar story. There's a lot of successful people that we can look at now who did not go to college.
Right.
And it's it surely defines that there's different types of people in the world. Some that would need an education. Maybe they're not focused on whatever their passions are, and they have no clue what direction they want to go in, and they can go, you know, and college will help kind of define a direction for them. And then there's people who just kind of know what they're passionate about. Now, I was a little different. I went to advertising. I wanted to be an illustrator, but I got picked up in advertising and followed that. But then I knew that the passion was illustration. I didn't feel I was good yet. So I did go to the college route. I didn't finish, but, you know, so that's, it's interesting that college is always a conversation when I'm talking to successful people. And a lot of them just chose a different path because they knew what their passions were.
Yeah. I mean,
you're good.
I think it's always an interesting thing regarding college. And yeah, it's definitely, as artists, we're always learning. So there's always some level of education going on. But I always felt that, and I've given this advice out to a lot of students that I meet, you know, when I do portfolio reviews and things like that, is if you know what you want to do and you have a passion for it, if you could find an internship job or some way to actually work, you know, at a company for the type of art that you want to do, to me, that's preferable to going, you know, over going to college, at least initially. Because just getting kind of like boots on the ground in the actual industry that you want to be in, you learn so much more at that point. So I feel like try that first. If that doesn't click, then yeah, then absolutely, you know, go to college and hone your craft. But I always feel like experience is the best education.
Yeah. And not only that, I mean, you were always a talented person. I mean, we used to come over to my house and I would just watch you draw. And you were always very, but when I saw your arms and your hands draw, it was like you kind of already naturally picked up the technique. So tell me a little bit about that. Like, is that the case? Was it just natural that you kind of just started drawing the way you did? Or was it just a lot of practice or looking over people's shoulders or influence, or what do you think was your drive to get to the point of drawing the way you did?
Well, I always loved cartooning and animation. I mean, from a very, very early age, and my brother shared that same love and interest, and he's older than I am. He's 5 years older. So there was always that influence going on in the house, right? You know, and we were always watching the Warner Brothers, the Chuck Jones and the Bob Clampett, Bugs Bunny cartoons. And also being in New York, there was a lot of exposure to animation that you wouldn't normally see. I know that anime wasn't in fashion at the time, but there was a small like underground movement that really loved anime. So you were able to kind of see some rare anime at the time, some early Miyazaki stuff like My Neighbor Totoro, Lupin the Third, Pastel Cagliostro. So I think that there was a lot of really positive influence. And I think that when you see that much creativity, you want to be creative yourself. So you just start drawing. And one of the best pieces of advice that I was ever given is you have 10,000 bad drawings in you. So draw as quickly as you can to get those bad drawings out. So it's kind of true, because the more hours you put into a craft, the better you ultimately get at it, so long as you love doing it.
Well, that's a great way of changing the way you just say, hey, you need to practice.
Yeah.
It's the same in basketball. It's the same in different sports, but it's really the same in terms of art, because, you know, the more you practice, the more, like you said, you get the bad stuff out, and then you get really good at what you consistently do.
Right.
So, all right. So when you were a kid, okay, your brother was in. So did you just go to Disney and say, hey, I'm this guy's brother, can I get in? Or what was the application process like? Do you remember?
Okay, this is going to be a period of my life that doesn't even make sense to me even today. So my brother was in, and I pretty much, I had an in. I mean, they knew my work. And for some reason or another, I decided I wanted to see what regular working life was like first. I don't know why. So I took a job at Photomat. So I was at Photomat in Brooklyn for 2 weeks. And it was not a positive experience. And it just for some reason it reiterated in my head of how much I wanted to be an artist. Maybe that's what the fate experience was. I don't know. But once I realized, yeah, this is not the path I want to be. I wanted to be an artist anyway. So yeah, I just kind of, you know, brought my portfolio again, kind of reapplied in a way, but you know, there was already an interest. So how many times
do you think you had to apply? I mean, I know they knew who you were, but.
It was just once. It was pretty much, the first gig I took at Disney, I remember, was to do the drawings for two Christmas ornaments. And so that was like a freelance. So initially it was a freelance job because they want to test you out. They want to see if you can, you know, make the schedule and that sort of thing. And it did, and it worked out great. And yeah, I got hired on staff pretty quickly thereafter. But nice. Yeah, and I still have those Christmas ornaments.
Okay. Enough. So now they probably sell for a lot of money by now.
I hope so.
And then have you ever autographed any of those ornaments? Has anybody ever done that to you? Like,
no.
You know you did this ornament?
There's been a couple of pieces that I've done that have actually oddly had gotten attention later. There was like this wrapping paper of Mickey with a bunch of different expressions that people seem to like. I've seen a couple of those. Some people have asked me about that. There was actually stuff. I did stuff for Jim Henson right around that time, also while I was working in New York. And there was some pieces I did for Muppet Babies that seemed to come around every now and then. And people say, did you draw this? And yeah, and I did. So yeah, it's kind of fun how sometimes things kind of circle back around to you.
Now, when I talk about with artists, especially those who went to high school with us, because there's a few artists that went to high school with us that did become successful and things of that nature. And New York is part of the conversation. You bring New York up a lot. And I know we had talked earlier about how Moon Girl is set in New York. And it was an interesting atmosphere at the time. It was very dynamic. It was very, there was something in the air, so to speak, especially because you also had Marvel, which you mentioned earlier, and DC, which were within walking distance of each other.
That's right.
So and then you had all these artists. Then you had the dynamics of what was going on in the business, the goods, the bads, and all that type of stuff. Of course, now fast forward, and Disney now has Marvel, so that's amazing. But you're mentioning New York a lot, and I know there's an influence in this cartoon. Tell me about your thoughts of New York, because now you're in LA.
Well, I think both you and I were super fortunate to be growing up in New York at that particular time.
It was
because, like I said before, it definitely felt like it was kind of an apex of creativity in a lot of ways. And High School of Art and Design was a great place to go as well because it had many different artists from many different walks of life that wanted to do many different things. So you had fashion designers, you had cartoonists, you had illustrators, you had advertising. So you had all these different artists. Sorry, what?
Toy designers.
Toy designers, right. So yeah, so you had all these different types of artists just kind of sparking off each other and mixing together. And I do remember that a lot of the artists that I got along with in a really great way was a whole bunch of graffiti artists. I mean, at the time, they were considered, and I use air quotes for this, criminals. But they were looking to find a way to express themselves. And I remember that they bring the black books, right? That had the thick black covers and the white pages. And then they would kind of plan out, right? What the piece they were going to do. And they would ask me sometimes to draw like a cartoon character or something in there because that wasn't their forte. Their forte was design and the lettering and the aesthetic. So I used to kind of contribute in that way, but that's what was so magical about it is you had all these different type of artists that probably never would have connected in any other way except for the school finding a way to kind of bring them all together. Excellent. And graffiti and street art was definitely coming alive at that point. And I was really glad to be there to kind of see it happen.
Awesome. So, okay, let's get into, well, all right, so you're done with Disney. You did some work there. Let's quickly skip through some of the things that you did accomplish and do. So, sure. so you did some things in Disney, and then what was next? What was your next project after that?
So then I fell in love with a show called Ren and Stimpy. I saw the pilot for Ren and Stimpy. I fell in love, moved out to LA, didn't know anybody here, found out where the studio was, got an apartment in walking distance of that studio, and got a gig there. And
that's awesome.
And that started my directing career. And my career has been very confusing to my agent and anyone that looks at a resume, because it goes from adult to preschool, back to adult to tweens. There's little consistency in it, but I think that kind of shows my ongoing fascination with all different types of storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause I feel like every no matter what age group you're aiming it at, there's still an interesting story to tell. It leads up probably to Kim Possible. So, Kim Possible was a really important show for me. It was, 4 seasons. So it was a long time. It was a long period.
Yeah.
I think I did about 50 plus episodes, if not more. And it's still, the legacy of that is still very strong. You can go to any comic book or movie sci-fi convention and you're going to see a Kim Possible cosplayer.
Nice.
Around. Call Me, Beat Me is still in the pop culture vernacular. So that's a show that was really rewarding. And then also a thing that was really special about that show was it was a female empowerment story.
Mm.
Because there wasn't a lot of strong female protagonists at the time. We had Buffy the Vampire Slayer and Xena. But Kim was one of the first. And so I think it was really great to be able to put that kind of message out there. It was a really rewarding experience.
So you went, like, and you just kind of quickly ran through that. You went from being an artist to a storyteller.
Yep.
What snapped? Like, what, like, and how did they accept it? Like, you know, I imagine, okay, so you're going to go and you walk into Ren and Stimpy's offices and say, I've been doing animation or drawings for products and stuff like that for some time, but I want to direct. How do they be like, yeah, sure, whatever. We just accept any director. Like, how does that work?
It took a minute for Ren and Stimpy to kind of get to that place. I think that it's the working experience. It's, when I got there, I was so dedicated to the craft. I didn't really have a social life. I didn't really have anything other than focus on work. And I think it was the right place, right time to be able to do that, because I think that I was able to learn the craft quickly. I do think that storytelling is an amazing type of skill that does evolve over time, because actually, let me jump even forward a little bit more.
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't remember how many years ago it was, but I ended up working for DisneyToon Studios, which is a feature division. So they're making movies, and I had never done movies before. And it was working directly for John Lasseter. And
right.
So
what we did with our other interview, which was the,
take around Love, Legend of the NeverBeast. Right. Yeah, right. Yeah. That's right. And jumping into that, there was a whole new process of storytelling, because now Lasseter wanted you to come up with your own personal story, apply that, you know, to a movie idea thematically, which was an interesting experience. I never had to do that before. And then once you prepare some level of work, either it's a script or a story or a pitch, you then pitch it to a story trust, a group of your peers, other directors, other writers, other artists, to get feedback. And that was an unusual environment. And at first, I think I was a little confused, a little surprised by it, because it's basically an hour and a half of people just telling you what's wrong with your work. But what you start to realize that this is all making it really great. This is all adding to it. And the end product is the thing that really everyone should be caring about. I mean, I think about legacy a lot, in that as artists, it's important that we're leaving behind something that matters, something that means more than us, because it, you know, people don't know my name now. They may know some of my work, but it's the work that I want to live on. I want it to be impactful and make a difference in someone's life. So all the pain you go through, or all the doubt, or all of those things, you got to kind of push through all that, because ultimately it's the work that will stand the test of time.
Understood. Wow. Okay. So I know we're really here to focus on Moon Girl.
Yeah.
So last time we had spoken, you had worked on Tinkerbell and The Legend of the NeverBeast. And now we fast forward. So I'm sure there was some in between. What were you doing in between?
In between that, I was on a couple of different shows. But right before Moon Girl, I have a show called The Ghost and Molly McGee, with my friends Bill Motz and Bob Roth. It is a very quirky show. That's kind of I think one of my signatures is quirk. It's about a girl, Molly McGee, the ultimate optimist, the ultimate positivity character, that moves to this depressed town, and there's this ghost that lives there, a ghost named Scratch, whose job it is to maintain the town's depression. But her optimism and his grumpiness kind of forms an odd couple type of scenario. And it's a really funny, quirky, odd couple type comedy. It's a really...
Yeah, she's very friendly to him, right? Like,
yeah.
I saw the first episode. Well, I've seen a few of the episodes, but that was one thing in the first episode that I caught, was like, it's like she really likes him. Yeah. And I think it's really...
She sees the good in everybody, and it's, I think that's the thing about the show that I love, is it's just really about, it's about optimism, it's about positivity, you know, it's something that we really need today. So yeah, I do love that show. Yeah, and it's currently on Disney Channel on Disney Plus, but yeah, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I've caught it on Disney Plus. It's really, really good. Okay. And so now you also have this project with a character of Marvel's.
Yes.
And what I find fascinating is one of the things that you had promoted on social media at first was that there's another executive producer with you.
Yes.
Please.
Yes. My producing partners on the show, Lawrence Fishburne and Helen Suglin from Cinema Gypsy, which is the production company that has created Blackish, Grownish, Mixedish. They're superstars. I mean, the best in the field. So it starts, the origin of the show starts with Lawrence Fishburne in a comic book store. He's a big comic book fan. And he would go, you know, Wednesday when the new titles would come out. And he went one day and he saw Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur. And he's like, I remember reading Moon Boy, and I remember reading Devil Dinosaur, you know, way back when, but this is new. And so he picked it up and he fell in love with it. And he brought it to Helen Suglin and said, I think we need to make a show out of this. So calls were made to Disney and to Marvel. And when Cinema Gypsy calls, you take that call. And deals were made. And
that's so cool.
Yeah, they just recognized the importance of this, because one of the things that kind of is unique about it is it's the first African-American teen girl superhero on TV. So it was kind of a big deal initially.
Wow.
Yeah, think about it. It's crazy.
Think about it. Okay. Yeah, because we had some women. But you're right. It does come together and it makes total sense now.
Very, very long overdue. So we recognize the importance of that. And I was brought on board because Lawrence liked my work. Lawrence actually knew my work from the movies and stuff. So, and it just made a lot of sense with a very strong female protagonist as your lead character to just kind of join this show. And when Lawrence and I met initially to just kind of talk about the vision for the show, we clicked instantaneously of the type, but not only the type of stories we wanted to tell, but the way we wanted them to be portrayed. So what the show is about Lunella Lafayette, who is a 13-year-old super genius. She is actually one of the smartest people in the entire Marvel universe. And she creates this device, this portal device thing. And it actually transports a giant red dinosaur into the Lower East Side. And naturally, when you have a giant red dinosaur as a friend, you would partner with him to fight crime on the streets of New York City. I mean, I think that's what anybody would do in that case. So the show is about those adventures of Lunella Lafayette, aka Moon Girl, and Devil Dinosaur fighting crime and, you know, helping people where they needed to be helped.
Now, I'm going to show a few of the images that we have of the character. So tell us a little bit about the settings that we're looking at.
It is accurate New York City in a lot of different ways. Looking at this image right here, one of the things you'll see is diversity, because that was really important to us. Growing up in New York City, it was everybody was there, and that's what made it such a wonderful place to grow up in. So you see that, and you'll also see that everything...
Is that right? This looks like Washington Square Park, is that right?
You're right, exactly. That's the other thing, is all of the locations are accurate. We wanted to make sure that New York felt real. I've seen New York represented in a lot of different forms, films and TV, and they never quite get it right. I remember watching one project where a bunch of characters chasing another bunch of characters over a set of hills. And I was like, there's no hills in New York City. That's not right. So I wanted to make sure that this was accurate. So where Lunella lives and all the neighborhoods that she interacts with are the actual places you will see. And you'll see also some of the design and art sensibility through some of these pieces. One of the things that we wanted to kind of get across is a different art style than you've ever seen. One of the big inspirations was Spider-Verse, was the Spider-Verse movie, which is an incredible movie, easily one of the best superhero animated films ever created. And we recognize how it really pushed the genre. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to kind of make our mark too, but we certainly didn't want to copy the greatness of Spider-Verse, but we wanted something to be as equally as great. So we kind of went in the opposite direction, where you'll see that a lot of the characters have a very pen and ink drawing sensibility. It looks like it was drawn, you know, with India ink, with a brush or a crow quill. And yep. You have these things called spotted blacks, which are you color in blacks you'll see on her sleeves and stuff, kind of a way to eliminate, in comic books, it was a way to eliminate color, because color process, you know, the more colors you add, the more expensive.
Yeah.
So we kind of threw all of that kind of hand-drawn sensibility together, and the background and the location of it was also very influenced by New York City, because we took the work of Basquiat, of Andy Warhol, of Keith Haring, and in particular, actually, the Andy Warhol silk screening process, that dirty Xerox you would get after, you know, printing something over and over and over again. And we kind of threw all that together with a touch of a street art graffiti sensibility and created this unique look that I feel that you haven't really seen, certainly not in animation.
Oh, I love it. I think it's refreshing, so to speak. But it also reminds me of the 80s and 90s that we grew up in high school, in that era.
Absolutely.
So it kind of brings me back into that time period. So tell us about the story. So she brings this dinosaur into New York.
Right.
But tell us about her.
Well, it's a one girl can make a difference story, because at the beginning of the first episode, there's a need for a superhero. Someone needs to step up. And Lunella has this giant brain, and she can create all these amazing inventions, all these amazing devices, but she didn't quite have the brawn to go along with the brains. She's an expert roller skater, because actually her family owns the last roller rink in New York City, Roll With
Wow.
It. So she was on skates since she was an infant. So she's got these amazing roller skating skills. But now with Devil Dinosaur, he has the ability to actually fight crime. So Lunella's career starts out small. It's just kind of some local criminals causing some trouble. But as her world expands, it starts to bring in a bunch of other, some familiar Marvel villains to the table. Because really? When you've got, you know, a new superhero in town flexing her power, it's going to, you know, create some attention.
So give us an idea of what Marvel characters come into play.
Well, there's a couple that's okay. There's so I'm trying not to give away too many spoilers.
Yeah, let's leave that up to surprise, but
I can talk about a few that have already been announced. Lawrence Fishburne plays the Beyonder. So
that's right. So
this is absolutely incredible. So the Beyonder is a well-known character in Marvel history. He's very well known for the Secret Wars. Right. So here's a funny story. So initially when we were developing the show, I was pitching the stories to Kevin Feige, who's in charge of Marvel mm-hmm. MCU. And I had mentioned, I wanted to use the Watcher at one point. And he asked, okay, well, in what way? And I would describe it. And he goes, I think I'm doing something with the Watcher on something else I'm doing. How about the Beyonder? I was like, you're gonna give me the Beyonder? It's like, have the Beyonder, have at it. I was like, this is awesome. So when I brought that to Lawrence, I said, because I knew we wanted to find a role for Lawrence that was going to maximize, you know, Lawrence Fishburne. So the Beyonder was the perfect character. So Lawrence is easily one of the finest actors, one of the best actors ever. So I got to see his process, which is great. I would on the phone with him a few times, and we talk about the character, talk about the direction, even before we talk about the voice, just kind of talk about what do you think this character's history is? Who do you think this character is? I want to get inside the head of this character. And then Lawrence would look at designs and he'd contribute to ideas, and he crafted the character. And then when we got into the record booth, there was quite a bit of time spent of him trying out voices, figuring out what's going to work best for the character. I mean, it was witnessing a masterclass in acting. I have to admit, it's absolutely incredible.
You're a very lucky man. But, there's a few actors and actresses that I look up to. You had Rosario Dawson.
Yes, Rosario Dawson, also incredible. Yeah,
and I got a chance to briefly work with her on a concert that I had produced, and she was a participant, which was fantastic. Sweetest woman ever, like it's amazing. So you're very fortunate to work with Morpheus of the Matrix on this cartoon. So go ahead.
I've been very fortunate in my career to work with a caliber of actor that has just not only been incredible, but enhanced the work, because what Lawrence is bringing to the table with Beyonder is really special and really unique. And it's almost like if you listen to it, you may not even recognize that it's Lawrence Fishburne doing the voice, because it's that different than what he would normally do. And the character, the Beyonder, is a really mercurial, bizarre, quirky character that changes moods and changes his emotions at the drop of a hat. So it's a really flexible, fun character. And so you take that and you take this amazing voice performance, and then you take the possibilities of a character who's an alien character, who's a godlike character, and can just snap his fingers and change dimensions, change his look. His body can separate from his head. He can transform into whatever he needs to at any given moment.
I didn't know that.
The possibilities are endless. And I think that we maximized the Beyonder because we love that character so much. But yeah, it's really special.
You may not want to reveal this. I was going to ask, but you know, I'll be gentle. Is there any cohesion between this cartoon and these characters to the MCU or the cinematic MCU?
Well, my feeling is, because I grew up reading comics, so I know kind of the lore and the history of these characters kind of from the beginning. And I know the brilliant way that the MCU has kind of retranslated these characters into a different medium. And I recognize that in a lot of ways, kids' experiences are the MCU in the same way that comics were our experience because we didn't have these wonderful movies and TV shows. So I wanted to make sure the show was as complementary as we could to the MCU. So though I wouldn't say that we're in the exact timeline of the MCU, there's definitely stuff from the MCU in the show. There's a couple of characters coming up. There's some announced cast members that if you put two and two together, you may say, I wonder if they're playing a character that I'm familiar with. What's that? But because I love the MCU films. I mean, Guardians of the Galaxy is one of my favorite films of all time.
I can see that. I can see
Yeah, it's
it lines up
what
with your quirkiness.
quirkiness, right? And it was such a fresh and original film with a talking, kick butt raccoon and a talking tree and it's just what a brilliant movie. And Iron Man, I mean, I could go on and on about the
What I
MCU
love
films.
about that movie is that they sell it.
Yeah.
Because if you just listen to your description and I'm telling, let's say, a friend that who's not into comics or something, they'd be like, yeah, I think I'm just gonna pass on that.
Right. It
You watch it
sounds
and it's like it's sold. Like you just get involved into the story. Yeah, absolutely.
It's, you know what, and to that credit, and it's also just kind of a good moment of just how brilliant filmmaking can be. The first scene in Guardians of the Galaxy is Peter Quill, Star-Lord, and he's on a planet. It's all mysterious and stuff like that. And then he puts on his Walkman, and then you've got like a 70s, I think it's like, what's the song? Come, Show Me Your Love. And it's just, and the mood just shifts. And it just suddenly turns into this crazy fun thing. And so that's just the power of filmmaking. And then you're in. And then so you don't have to think about, oh, why, what kind of film is this going to be? It doesn't matter. You're in. So it's just what a joy.
So you have these characters, and just like you had mentioned, Molly, and at its core, it's about positivity. What would you say is the core of Moon Girl?
I think it's one girl can make a difference. I think that it was important in Lower East Side that someone needed to step up and she did. And I think that you're going to see her influence of positivity kind of run through New York City because I think someone needed to step up and set an example, for everyone to start contributing and really defending, their neighborhood. So I think you're going to see that. And I think that also what the show exemplifies is STEM thinking and how, young girls can be scientists. They can be whatever they want to be.
Nice.
They could
Yeah.
be crime fighters. She's a super genius. She, fisticuffs is only part of the situation. She's brilliant. She can, create the device to solve the situation or in her brain figure out all the steps that are going to happen to prevent the situation from occurring. So I think it's great to have a character that you can look up to and say, yes, yeah, science is cool.
So I want to show a clip of the show. And if you want, you can kind of tell us a little bit about it after.
Sure.
All right.
Genius vibe. I mean, I am the smartest 13-year-old. And now I have a dinosaur. Say cheese pizza. Now we got super villains.
doesn't go below 14th Street.
Oh, this day couldn't get any worse. If I don't clean up this crime, the LES is going downhill, and next thing you know, I'm moving to Jersey.
No disrespect to Jersey.
What do we do? What do we do?
Who are you supposed to be?
Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur. And Casey. Oh, no.
I got in way over my head, and I can't fix this.
Well, if you're looking to fix something, never too late.
Hey, we'll get through it. What do we do when the going gets tough?
We roll with it. Moon Girl Magic! Like my mom always says, one girl can make a difference.
Especially when that girl is you.
Yes, first thing I want to say is absolutely no disrespect to Jersey. I have a lot of friends in Jersey. I love Jersey. I want to point that out. So, because we're not saying it as a joke, we're saying, yes, we are not disrespecting Jersey. Other people may, we are not.
Very good.
So that's a good taste of the show. And you kind of get to see some of the styles in the show. You get to see some of the energy of the show. Music is a really big component of the show.
Mm-hmm.
So before I go into who's making the music, you'll even saw in some of those clips that the colors get abstract and interesting, because whenever Lunella puts on her mixtape and she fights a bad guy, the style of the show changes. Mm-hmm. It turns into something we call mixtape colors, and it becomes
Is that a direct influence because of Guardians of the Galaxy?
I would say it's a kind of a combination of a lot of things. I think it's, I had done some music videos for some bands. Mm-hmm. So I always love animating music videos, and I always love applying, abstract art to music. I don't know. It's always been something for me. So I think it was a combination of that and Edgar Wright's Baby Driver, to which I'm a massive, massive fan of. So I think there's a lot of things thrown together in the mix for that. So you get to see a lot of that in action in that trailer. But what you don't get is the music. And I want to mention that for a second. So the music, okay. Our music executive producer is the legendary Rafael Sadiq. He's a genius. I know that word gets thrown around a lot. But I have to say this is 100% true and earned, because he is absolutely one of the most brilliant people I've ever met. So Raphael was in a band called Tony 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 in the 90s. You may know some of the songs. It Never Rains in Southern California is one of their most famous songs. And he went on to a career of producing and his own solo work. He's produced John Legend, Beyonce. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. And so when I knew that I wanted him to work on this show, because I was such a massive, massive fan of his, I went to Disney and I said, hey, you know, what do you think about Rafael Sadiq? And everyone's like, oh man, that's a great idea. But he's a working musician. He's touring, he's got albums, he's always producing someone's work. It's like, I don't know, he might be too busy to do it. So what I did is I decided, okay, I had to kind of take matters into my own hands to try to convince him and beg him to do it. So he was doing a record signing at a record store in Hollywood, California, because he had an album out at that time called Jimmy Lee. So I made sure I was first in line. So when I get up to him and I hand him my record, and in the 30 seconds it took him to sign it, I pitched him the show. I pitched him the show in that 30 seconds. Then by the end of those 30 seconds, after he'd signed my album, I signed him onto the show.
Okay, but here's I mean, I know you're simplifying it. At least I think you are.
It's not.
What do you say? Like, hi, I am a Disney guy or a Marvel.
Yeah.
That's it. Like that perked his ears up.
It starts like that. It's okay. I probably talk a little faster than that. So it was like, Hi, Mr. Sadiq. My name is Steve Lohr. I'm the executive producer at Disney. I'm doing this amazing project. It's called Marvel's Girl Devil Dinosaur. It's about da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I think I did all of that, and your music will be great for it. Da-da-da-da-da. I can only think of you to do the music, so please, could you just hear it? It's like that.
Old. I am sold.
Yeah, and that was it. Wow. And so he gets, because his agents were there, and he says, I want to do this. Talk to this guy. And wow. So then I did a sidebar with his representation, and I gave them a fuller version of the story. And they're like, oh yeah, this sounds really great. So yeah, it was kind of a done. I mean, look, we always hear the old saying, never meet your heroes. But my theory on it is, yes, meet your heroes, because sometimes maybe they'll do music for your show. So I think that's always a, keep that in mind, kids.
I mean, what's fun is the stories. And then this is what I really wanted to get into, especially with someone like you. Like, you know, we went to high school, we have our stories, we shared some of them in our previous interview, but right place, right time, like those little cliche things sometimes are just the real thing. And if you have a little bit of clout, or if you've really honed in your skills, you can make things happen just by A, reputation, and B, the project's just got to be right. And if you really, you know, and so this is where I want to kind of start angling a little bit towards the concept of garage. Mm-hmm. Because you're a person that has been able to make a lot of different dreams that some people have into reality, right? Mm-hmm. And not everybody can do that. And not everybody can do that, they just don't think they can. But in reality, if they just honed in, they can, right?
Absolutely.
Like,
oh, absolutely.
Like, we're just two normal kids, and we were surrounded in this wonderful time period and wonderful world of art. We were lucky to be in a high school of art, which is hard for a lot of the rest of the world to maybe even comprehend. And at the time period, there was no computers. There was nothing. This was hand-drawn stuff that we all did. Mm-hmm. And what you did is you just kept pushing forward, where some others might have just given up. Like, usually when people get a no, that's a turnoff, and they stop or they quit, or it's, you know, negative to their personality. And one of the things that I want to make sure that we get across is, to me, you're pretty down-to-earth person. When we talk out of camera, we're just chilling. We're talking like regular people. And there isn't the Hollywood, what people see in movies as, right, as a representation of Hollywood, where everything's very stiff and very, like, it has to be in a very official, specific way, and you have to be the best, sure, of the best of the best. You know, I sucked as an artist, but what made me get picked up by books and album covers and what have you was I was able to get a deadline done. You know, you give me a 2-day deadline, I'm going to paint my ass off, excuse my terminology, to, you know, get the job done. And sure, I could have taken a month, but if the deadline is 2 days and I can do it, I'm going to get the job that another artist may not. So, you know, we'll get into that later, but.
Well, first off, you didn't suck as an artist. I want to point that out. I think you strike that from the record, but okay.
Well, the reason I say that is because we were surrounded, you know, I have to say, I was definitely not the best of anybody anywhere near in my school. Even when I went to college, I was nowhere near the best. I pushed forward. I got business, because in business, sometimes it's like we're talking about where you are, how you say, how you sell yourself, all that type of stuff. You have to be a business person to some extent, right? Right. To me right now, part of what you're talking about is you know the business. And you know what you're supposed to say or how you're supposed to represent yourself. You know all these things, because it's not just about the talent only. You also have to be the business guy and know how to make things move. So that's,
I think,
just
it's part of it.
Yeah, I mean, of course, it's just a piece of it.
Yeah, I think that because that's something that I had to, you know, learn as well. You know, I think that today it's an interesting time for students and for young filmmakers and young artists today, because there's so many more tools at their disposal. And it's a good thing, and it's a bad thing. And here's what I mean by that. You have all these computer programs that can do all different types of mediums. So painting, illustration, everything that is a added tool to get the job done. But the bad side to that is you kind of become a jack of all trades, master of none, because you're not focused on one particular aspect of art so that you can kind of really turn that into something that is really special and unique and that you do better than maybe anyone else. But I will say that, again, looking at the positive side of it, because there's so much tools at your disposal and you could film a movie on an iPhone, it's a good opportunity to get your voice heard or to get your work seen. Because I think, and I'll just speak for filmmaking for a minute. I think what makes filmmaking important and special is people's stories. And when I say that, I don't necessarily mean the stories that they come up with, which is part of it, but their own life experiences. And some of the more personal stories that you see that are done in movies and TV shows are the ones that really connect to an audience because it came from such a specific, authentic place. And I think that's something that is really what moves the needle. And because you have a phone and you can kind of make a version of your story, I hope that's what the future is. But I do think, yeah, and I hear like in the garage, because everything does start in the garage. All the ideas start in the garage. The first drawing, you know, the first sketch, the first idea, the first scribble on a notepad, that's where it happens. But then it's the vision expands, because then your vision should expand outside the garage. And I think that part of it is who you're bringing to the table. Bring people that will elevate you. Bring in people that will counter you, you know, because that's what makes great work. So you got to then surround yourself with people that are going to take your craft and elevate it. Bring them into the garage. You know, have work on stuff together. I think that that's a key thing. And then as far as the business goes, it'll fall into place about how, because I think that's an interesting thing in Hollywood is there is the perception of the typical Hollywood archetype personality and you know, how to deal with that person or how that person communicates and stuff like that. You'll figure it out. It's talent that shines through. It's talent, it's skill, it's craftsmanship, it's your personal story. That's the things that really make the difference.
Yeah, well said. Part of some of the things that I talk about to people is, and I'm gonna put it in more figurative language, you have to have your inner circle and your outer circle. And your inner circle, in people's heads, they think it's like your family and your friends and stuff like that. And I'm like, not really. I mean, they might be if they're like within the industry that you're looking to be in. But what you normally want to do is you want to have the inner circle be those supportive people. You know, people maybe in the industry, they might be investors, they might be, you know, computer programmers, people that can make what your ideas and passions are move. But you have to do it in a very delicate way because you also want to be an asset for them.
Absolutely.
Like you can't just be the one way, hey, I'm just going to always ask for a favor. You got to be in a position that they should ask you for a favor too, and they can feel your support and stuff like that. And they should be honest enough to be able to say, you know what, your idea is not going to work for honest reasons, not for jealousy or anything like that. Right. So, and then the outer circle can be your friends and stuff, but sometimes that could be overzealous. They can be like the negative and that's just not the right atmosphere right. to move forward.
You want to find a circle of people that are going to be truthful because again, it's all about the work. It's sometimes it's not about massaging an ego. It's about making this as good as it possibly can be. And even when, like you talk about when you're connecting or you're working with computer designers, this thing or that thing, what you're bringing to the table is a vision. right? You're bringing the germ of something to the table. And then you need to create a little bit of space to allow people to contribute to that vision. Because not only is it going to make it better, they're going to feel like they're part of the whole creative package. Because that's what you want, is you need to, you can't do it alone. You have to assemble a team.
Yes.
So, and but you have to share the vision, and you have to allow that vision to be shared.
100%. There's people who will literally preach, don't tell everybody your ideas. And to some extent, I can understand that. You know, there's a possibility of it getting stolen or whatever. You just have to be more strategic about it. You have to speak it into existence, so to speak. But you also have to do it in a to the right people, too. You can't just, you know, it's a waste of time to just tell everybody and anybody. You want to make sure that when you do tell it, that it's hitting the right ears that can help you make it, and you build your team that way.
Well, you know, another good piece of advice that I'd always heard was if you're, because again, you want to seek feedback out, and the people that give you thoughts or notes or something like that, and they start the sentence with, well, if I were doing this, I would do this that way. You don't necessarily want those people as part of your inner circle, because the people you want are, oh, okay, I get the idea you're going for. This is what I think you could do to really make that work or make that shine. You want people to elevate your ideas, not tell you this is how they would have done it. You want to support it. Yeah. So that's a key thing. And that's an important thing, because you don't, you can get tripped up on that. Whereas you then start to get enveloped in someone else's vision, but to find the right people that take your vision and maximize it is the team you want to surround yourself with.
Awesome. Ah, I wish we could have like a 5-hour show. All right. So, okay. So let's go back onto the track of Moon Girl. So you have this great, excellent music producer who's doing some fabulous music. And at the end of the show, we're going to share the music video of the show. But tell me a little bit of the voices, the people who are playing these characters.
We have an all-star cast. I mean, this cast is absolutely incredible. We have Diamond White plays Lunella Lafayette. Libe Barrere is playing her best friend, Casey. Fred Tatasciore is playing Devil Dinosaur. And a quick thing about Fred and his performance of Devil. When Fred does many voices. I mean, he does all kinds of voices, not just animal voices. His specialty is actually not animal voices. But when we were looking for someone to kind of do, you know, that kind of sound work, he came in and he said, you know, in the scripts, what I would really like, because this character is really key to the story, what is the character actually saying? Because in a script, sometimes you just write devil roars or da-da-da-da-da. Hmm. But he would prefer that we write it out as actual lines of dialogue, as if he's saying just a sentence in clean and plain English. And so he would use that, because he goes, okay, now I know the intention behind the sounds. Hmm. And so then he would do something that was, you could almost extrapolate, okay, what's the emotion? What's he trying to get across? And I thought that was absolutely brilliant. I'd never seen that before.
That's awesome.
So, I mean, that's a level of care that our amazing voice actors are putting into it. And some of the other amazing cast we have is, I previously mentioned Lawrence Fishburne. We have Jermaine Fowler, Sashir Zameda, Gary Anthony Williams, and the legendary Alfre Woodard, who's unbelievable. I mean, another masterclass in acting every time she does a session. So yeah, it's an absolutely incredible cast. And we have a variety of really amazing guest stars. Maya Hawke, Method Man. We have Method Man.
Oh.
Yeah.
Nice.
It's absolutely incredible.
Well, that's exciting. I can't wait to see like the episodes and hear their voices and try to figure out, okay, I can hear that person. I can try to visualize them. But no, I mean, they're trying to be these cartoon characters, which is great.
Yep.
So, all right. So how many episodes is it total?
So season one, which comes out which comes out February 10th on Disney Channel and shortly thereafter on Disney Plus, is, I think we are, it was around 17 episodes or so is kind of the zone that we're in. Yeah, the first episode is a 44-minute mini movie. The origin of Moon Girl. So there's a lot of adventures. And there's an arc. So there's some serialization that goes through the series. You see Lunella kind of grow into her role as Moon Girl. So it's really fun.
Nice. So you had mentioned, and I could be wrong, is there going to be a season two?
Yes. We were just at New York Comic Con in October, which was a fabulous experience. We got to meet some of the fans in person that are already supporting the show, which is absolutely incredible. And we were able to announce at the convention that we've been picked up for season two, even before any episode from season one has aired, which is a real sign of faith from Walt Disney Company that we've got something really special, which is incredible. I mean, you don't get that in the industry, but I think we all agree that there's plenty of stories to tell for Lunella Lafayette and Devil Dinosaur.
Awesome. Now, are there any other projects that you're kind of working on?
I always have stuff rolling around. I like to have a couple of projects going. I'm that kind of guy where I can't stop working. I'm always thinking of new stuff and new ideas. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I have a couple of things coming, hopefully in the near future. For now though, the focus right now is on Ghost of Molly McGee, and in particular the launch of Marvel's Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur.
That's wonderful. All right, well, you've been with us for some time, and I know you got other things to do, but let me see if there's anything else I can think of that I want to ask you. I think we've kind of gone through the whole rundown. We're living in a different world. When you started, you were using pencil, you were using paintbrushes, and now a lot of that stuff is computerized. So do you want to share any thoughts for the people that are starting in the new garages? In terms of, okay, the world is going in this direction. Obviously, the formula for success will be different for them as it was for you. Mm-hmm. What kind of thoughts or what can you share in that respect?
I think, you know what, if you boil it down to anything that's creative, and I mean anything, so it can be film, it could be painting, it could be anything that is a creative art, it starts with emotion. Emotion. Emotion is universal. Emotion is something we all have, we all feel. I mean, we have all had things happen in our lives that are universal, that are completely relatable. So I think that make your emotion authentic. Tell your story, because I think that's what we all need to see. I mean, even if you're doing something that is fantastical, if you're writing a sci-fi story, or you're making a movie or a TV show, or you're doing whatever, you can find ways to kind of insert your own personal experiences and your own emotional journey into those characters. And that's what's going to be authentic. That's what's going to connect you to your audience. So that's kind of my biggest piece of advice, and it's something that I certainly live by.
Thank you. Steve,
thank you,
man. I wish you lived down the block so we can, you know, because I can just imagine the hours of conversation we would have in just about everything. There's things that I'm working on, obviously something like this show, but, you know, launching of a few other things in the beginning of the year. So I hope that I can share in that adventure as much as I'm sharing in your adventures. Tell people where they can find you. I actually am going to put the Linktree link on screen, but you can share how people can follow you.
Sure. I'm on Instagram and I'm Twitter. And my handle is Steve Loader on both. So yeah, I love to hear from people, love to know what you think of the show when it comes out. So yeah, just follow me on those.
Thank you, man, buddy. I love you.
I love you too. This has been incredible.
These are great with you and your family. And I will make it to LA at some point and visit you. I promise you.
Please do.
Yeah, my daughter is out in San Francisco. So, you know, I have to make it like a thing, a trip. I haven't had a chance to do that. So we're not just going to end the show abruptly. We're going to see the music video produced, I believe. Is that right? By Raphael?
Yes. Composed and produced by. Yes.
Awesome. So thank you very much for joining. Those of you, thank you for watching the first episode of Garage. I have to come up with a better name than that, but that's the name.
I think it works. Honestly, it all starts there. Walt Disney, his first drawing of Mickey Mouse, he did in a garage.
It's funny. Amazon, garage. He started selling books out of his garage. Apple, garage. Yeah. Hewlett Packard, garage. So I can go on. There's garage bands. I mean, so that's why I wanted to have this as the name. And we're also doing t-shirts and other stuff. I'll probably grab a quote that you might have said and turn that into a t-shirt to help inspire creativity and so on. So, but I'm not going to put the website here. I'll do that some other time. But let's check out the music video. And thank you all for watching. Make sure you follow. This may be also a podcast. So those who are listening, thank you for listening. I'll also probably have this on YouTube and so on. So let's check out the music video.
Dinosaur?